Hi everyone. In today's video, I want to talk about the synchronized keyword in Java, which is something used in the context of multithreading. One of the great things about multithreading is it allows concurrent execution of your code, but one of the bad things about multithreading is that it allows concurrent execution of your code. The synchronized keyword is one of the great tools in a programmer's tool belt to basically control how concurrency behaves in certain blocks of code. Let's go ahead and get into IntelliJ with a few examples. Today's project, we're just going to call synchronize. And now to start, what I'm going to do is I'm going to write some code with and without the synchronized keyword to demonstrate the difference. I'm going to get some code up that looks similar to one of our previous multi-threading videos, and then I'm going to modify it to basically use some shared data and show how the synchronized keyword can help us out. All right, so walking through this code a little bit, the first thing is that we're creating an instance of our data holder. Which all that our data holder is you can call it like a POJO, a plain old Java object. It's basically an object reference that is hiding this data field right here because I can't operate directly on the primitive integer data. So what I'm doing is I'm making an object reference that just holds onto the data for me. The next thing we have here is we have an executor service which can submit up to 10 different runnable tasks. And then we loop over all the potential tasks, and then we submit the same task for all of them. And the task right here is that we are looping from 0 to just 1 minus 10,000, so 9,999. And we are incrementing our data each of those times. So what we would expect is that if we had one thread running this code, the value of data at the end would equal 10,000. And what you would think is that you have 10 threads doing this, you would think it would be 100,000 because it would be 10,000 times 10, right? Wrong. Let's go ahead and run the code and I'll show why that's wrong. Interesting. So we expected to get a value of 100,000, but we only got 94,915. Well, you might think, do you have something going on with like integer overflow or something like that? But if I do 10,000 times 10, that's 100,000. Integer overflow on Java is not going to happen until just over 2 billion. So we're nowhere near that. So do I have some code logic issues? If we look through here, we are just incrementing our data. And all of the data over here is doing is it's just adding 1 to it each time. Now, what's actually happening is we're having a problem where our threads are stomping on each other. And that's because data plus plus, the equivalent of this would be something like this. So there are actually a few main things going on in this one line of code. We are doing a read of the value of data at the time of the start of when we enter the method. And then we add 1 to that value and then assign it back. So we're doing a read and a write. So what this is actually doing is if you have two threads that come in here at the same time, they may read data before the new value of data is assigned back. So let's say that data equals 80,000 when we enter this function and we've got two threads that are entering it. Both threads are going to read out a value of 80,000 and then both are going to write a value to data of 80,001 instead of 80,002. So interesting, how do we prevent that? Well, one way we can do it is we can add the synchronized keyword. Basically what the synchronized keyword does with methods is it ensures that anyone who calls into this method in the context of the parent object, you can only have one thread at a time enter it. I'm gonna go ahead and demonstrate the difference here. I'm gonna go ahead and hit run. We'll see that this time that the values are gonna equal. And there we go, cool. So just to talk through that again one more time, the synchronized keyword in the context of a method, what that means is that only one thread can enter this method at any given time. So what we're doing is we are protecting the integrity of our data field because we are both reading and writing to it only from a single thread. This does, as you might imagine, slow down our code slightly, but in the context of getting the wrong answer fast versus getting the right answer slow, I would rather get the right answer slow than the wrong answer fast. So another way that we can accomplish the same thing is I can get rid of the synchronized keyword in the method declaration and I can add a synchronized block. And what this does is it basically takes an expression here which needs to be an object reference. And the object reference has what's called a monitor, which is what we are locking and unlocking. That's a lot of terminology. I'll get into that here in a second. But basically, we need an object reference here. So the most common object reference you'll see is this. So this code that I have right here is equivalent to the code I had earlier where I had synchronized within the method declaration, because a method declaration synchronized and a synchronized block synchronized onto this keyword are semantically equivalent. I'll go ahead and run the code and tweak a few numbers to demonstrate that we're getting the same thing. So that time we can see that we upped the ante. We went from 10,000 iterations to 100,000 iterations. Therefore, the expected value of data at the end would be 1,000,000. And the actual value is also 1,000,000 as well. Cool. So again, when you add a synchronized block over the this keyword that extends over an entire method like this one does, versus if you add the synchronized keyword and the method declaration of an instance method, those behave the same. Now, a synchronized block generally is going to be preferred over a synchronized method. And the reason for that is because, as I said earlier, when you're dealing with concurrent programming and now you only have one thread entering a method at a time, that's going to slow down your program. So you want to make sure that your synchronized blocks only do the minimum required synchronization. So let's say some code here and some code here. And neither of these require concurrent protection, then it would be better if I had a synchronized block rather than a synchronized method. And that's because it's going to be more timing critical that only the minimum area I need required is within synchronized. So going back to a few terms that I mentioned earlier, monitor, lock, and unlock. The nice thing about the synchronized keyword is it abstracts some of that from us. So basically what's happening here is this keyword, the object reference that we're passing in to the synchronized statement, that holds what's called a monitor. Every object reference within Java has a monitor. And what you can do is you can lock and unlock a monitor. At the top of a synchronized block, we're performing a lock. Then similarly, at the bottom, we are performing an unlock. And then the lock and the unlock that we are doing is on this. So what does a lock really mean? What it means is that if I have a thread coming in here, so I have thread one that just entered the increment method, and I look at this synchronized block right here, I attempt a lock on the this monitor. If thread one tries to attempt a lock and there's no other thread holding the lock, then it can go into the synchronized block. So now thread one is currently in the synchronized block and thread two comes along. Now what happens is thread two tries to get a lock on the this monitor, and it has to wait for the lock because thread one still has it and is in here. So thread two is now currently waiting for the lock. Thread one still has it. Thread one finishes the synchronized block and unlocks its monitor and then keeps going. And then now thread two can get the lock that it was waiting for, and then it enters here. That's why we have deterministic behavior when we use synchronized, because we are locking a shared resource, which is the this monitor. What if instead of a shared monitor, I used a non-shared monitor? Let's think about how we could do that for a second. What if I create a new object? Think about that for a second. New object. That creates a new object reference. And I mentioned earlier that an object reference is tied to a monitor. Therefore, each new object reference represents a new monitor. So what would you think would happen here? I have thread one that comes in here and gets the lock on the monitor associated with this object reference. But then thread two comes in and I think it's going to have a new object reference and it's going to be able to get a lock as well. Let's go ahead and run our code and see what happens when the monitor changes. Aha! We can see that the monitor is critical. Now we're back to our code not doing what we want it to do, even though we're using the synchronized keyword. Just because you add the synchronized keyword doesn't mean that your code is now thread safe. You need to look at it critically and make sure that it does what you would expect. Basically, every thread that were to enter this method needs to have some sort of shared object reference whose monitor it tries to get a lock on. So the easy way that most people do that is they just use this. That's the long reason for why synchronized over this is usually the right answer, but not always. You could also just as easily make an object reference up here. And then you could synchronize over your object reference. This will work because you have an instance variable that's associated with your class. And now you know whoever tries to access your class, or at least the current instance of your class, and they try to get the monitor associated with your object field here, you know that you're gonna have consistency. So I'll go ahead and demonstrate that this works as expected. Okay, great. So this is working as expected again. So just to summarize, the synchronized keyword, while useful in the context of concurrent programming, alone doesn't mean that your code is thread safe. You've got to make sure that the object references monitor that you are synchronizing over is actually shared among various threads that might enter your method. And then basically what the synchronized block is doing is it's performing a lock and an unlock along the context of this block here. And then in the context of a synchronized method, the locking happens when you enter the method and the unlocking happens when you exit the method. So another useful thing about the synchronized keyword is that if you had to abruptly exit your synchronized block, such as an exception getting thrown, that gets handled because when you have an exception thrown, you leave the scope of your current block. And just like a try catch finally, where a finally always gets executed, you basically guarantee that your monitor gets unlocked when your exception gets thrown, assuming that your exception leaves the synchronized block. I'll go ahead and demonstrate that really quick. Excellent. So we can see that our result is still the same, even though we had an exception get thrown. And that was an overview of the synchronized keyword within Java. Today we covered monitors, locking and unlocking in the context of synchronized, and the difference between a synchronized block and a synchronized method. I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you did, please do smash that like button. If you had any thoughts on the video, please do drop a comment below. If you haven't gotten a chance to subscribe to the channel yet and you're enjoying the content, please do so. I'd really, really appreciate it. Thank you for watching today's video. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.